Hello, my name is Christopher, and we are at the high-end show in Germany. With me, I have Otto. We've already done some live these couple of days.
Yeah.
Today, or this time, we are trying to catch up on some of the great questions that we got in the past for Ask Expert, but just didn't have the time to answer. So Otto, let's jump right into it and start with the first one.
Sure.
This one is actually a more recent one, but I think it's a great question from Michelle. And she wants to know if there's any speakers that are fundamentally better for movies and some that are just better for music.
Yes, it's a very popular question that we get quite often, actually. But when you think about it, what is a movie? A movie is a very big part of movies is music.
Yeah.
So if you don't play music well, how are you going to play movies well? Yeah. If it's not good at playing music, it won't be good at playing movie soundtrack. An interesting thing is actually if you have a surround sound system and you remove the cable to the center speaker, so you're only hearing the left and right speaker, you will notice that you're basically hearing music and sometimes a few sound effects.
Okay.
But most of that is actually music. So if the left and right speaker doesn't play music well, I wouldn't call it a good speaker for movies.
Okay.
So that being said, there are low frequency effects in many movies that has a higher requirement of the output in the lower frequencies than what the demands are in music. So that's why you more often see a subwoofer in a movie setup.
Yeah.
Compared to music setups.
But fundamentally, it's about getting a great pair of speakers.
Yeah, on a fundamental level, the job is the same. It's about conveying the audio. It's about playing back the audio that's in the track. Whether or not that is music or movies doesn't actually change the loudspeaker's job. It's more important how large is the room, how loud do you want to play. That will make some differences to the compromises that you're eventually going to take. But the basic requirement of a loudspeaker is the same, to play back sound.
Yeah. And then it's all about going back to the basics, I guess, and figure out how big is my room, how far from the TV or the music am I, and just getting all of that sorted out and perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great. The next question is from Joe, and he's wondering why our speakers are so light, as he writes.
Yes. To be honest, we have to laugh a bit about at the question, not because there's something wrong with the question, but our speakers have a very different range.
Yeah.
In weight. And if you look at our evidence or consequence, but also our contour line, if you have a contour 20, which is a semi-big bookshelf speaker, but it's still more than 20 kilos, that's a very heavy speaker.
Mm.
So some of the ranges are more heavy than others, depending on the trade-offs we are taking. We're always trying to get very high quality drivers into our speakers. And sometimes you have to make compromises to get the best possible drivers into a cabinet. So the higher the price, the more we are able to put more bracing into the cabinets and make a thicker, more dead cabinet. So yeah.
But what are the advantages of having a more or a heavier cabinet?
Basically, what you want is to avoid the cabinet from adding any sound.
Yeah.
The drivers are playing, and that puts force into the cabinet. Mm. If the cabinet is vibrating, that is in itself making sound, and that's a distortion to the sound. So you want to get rid of that distortion.
And
so
the weight helps.
The more dead the cabinet is, the less distortion you get. And a dead cabinet is generally more heavy.
Okay.
You can also make it with different kinds of materials, but actually, sometimes it can be more beneficial to tune the resonance frequencies in the cabinet rather than simply making it heavier. It can be a bit of better trade-off to figure out a way to make it less intrusive to the sound without necessarily putting more money into making it heavier if we're trying to reach a specific price.
So what I hear you say is that it also really depends on what kind of loudspeaker you're developing. if yes. you make it lighter, heavier, or put bracing in or not? Or?
Yes, it's always a deliberate decision. It's not an accident where we are ending up. We're always looking at the end result. Like when we were discussing drivers, we're not trying to make the best possible drivers. We're also not trying to make the best possible cabinet. We're trying to make the best possible complete loudspeaker. Yeah. And the trade-offs are sometimes different, but that's, the goal is always the same.
And it's deliberate choices.
Yes.
Yes. Another question that we get quite often is people asking what kind of ohm they should go for with their amplifier, I think.
Yeah.
But I want to reframe it a little bit and then ask you, could you start by kind of explaining to me what it is?
I'll do my best. This can become a very big topic.
Yeah.
Could be a topic for other experts, so I'll try to keep it brief. But in short, if you have a lower impedance, if you have a lower ohm number, you will draw more power from the amplifier.
Okay.
So that makes the loudspeaker sound play louder,
okay.
simply because you're drawing more power out of the amplifier. But that also requires that the amplifier is actually capable of sustaining that power
Obviously.
And delivering that power. There's a very big difference to how this impedance curve actually works, because this you're looking at a number, but that number is actually an average.
Mm.
So if we're saying we have a 4-ohm speaker, two 4-ohm speakers can behave completely different and be a completely different load to the amplifier. If you have an impedance curve that varies a lot up and down, you can have a curve that goes down to 2 ohms in some frequencies, but still the average is 4.
Okay.
Then it will be a really difficult load to the amplifier.
Mm.
Our speakers generally have a very smooth impedance curve, so we don't have as large dips. For
and
instance, the Special 40 is a 6 ohm. Yeah, that makes it a lot easier.
Mm.
The Special 40 is a 6 ohm average, but the lowest dip is 4.8, and that makes it quite an easy load, because these dips where you have a very low impedance curve, that's actually what is difficult to drive for the amplifier.
Okay. Can you say anything? You mentioned now that our Special 40 is 6 ohms. Do we try to go for a specific ohm number, or is it really what suits the loudspeaker the best?
In general, we try to balance it so that we, like you said, get a smooth curve.
Yeah.
We have in the past generally tried to reach a 4 ohm impedance, because that's a good balance between how much you're actually drawing out of the amplifier and what most amplifiers are still able to drive, provided it's a smooth curve. So that is actually a fairly easy load for most okay. amplifiers. What we've been seeing is that some types of amplifiers, digital amplifiers, sometimes struggle if you have even close to 4 ohm loads.
Okay.
So as soon as you go much lower than 4 ohms, they can have problems. So it can be an advantage to go slightly higher. But again, as I said, it's an average. So. And just historically, you would always call it a 4, 6, or 8 ohm loudspeaker, but many of them are in reality, maybe it's 5.2,
yeah.
So we're calling it 6 because it's just
the
way it's rounded off
for,
historically. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So if we wanted to do it completely accurately, we would be showing all kinds of curves, which most people wouldn't understand anyway, and that's why we're basically pulling it down to this basic level. Most of our loudspeakers actually isn't a problem for the amplifier to drive. You basically have to look at put more power in if you want to play loud.
Yeah.
But most amplifiers don't actually struggle with
and as you said, they're easy to power because they have the smooth impedance curve.
Yes, yes, compared to other products. Yeah.
Let's move on to the next one. It's from Howie. It's a guy we talk quite a lot to on Facebook, so
yep.
it's nice to be able to answer a question here live
sure.
for him. He's already checked out the Special 40 and is curious to know if we're going to use any of the drive units in other loudspeakers.
Yes, in general we don't really comment on and off products. But you could say we already announced that the tweeter in the Special 40, which we're calling the Esotar 40,
yeah.
Actually is a unique driver for this speaker. So
yeah.
The current plan is not to use that in other products.
Okay.
And we're not expecting to change that. For the woofer, who knows?
Yeah, who knows? Great. Last question for you, Otto.
Yeah.
It's from Boyer Griffin, and he wants to know why we don't use a waveguide.
Yes. That's an interesting question, because the answer actually is that we do use a waveguide.
Yeah.
It's just a very small one. So if
could you start by explaining to me what it is?
Good idea.
Yeah.
Well, if you look at a tweeter like this, what we have, the dome is basically playing the sounds.
Yeah.
But then you have a shape of the plate.
No, the around plate, yeah.
Around the dome, and that shape is what we basically call a waveguide.
Yeah.
So the shape of this guide is crucial to the sound. It actually makes a very big difference to the sound.
Okay.
How you make this shape. If you put the dome further back, and you have a steeper shape, then you will kind of pull the sound in. You'll send the sound more directly forward to have less sounds to the sides. Then you'll have a louder sound to the listener.
Mm.
And you can also steer the sound if you don't want as much sound up or down. You can basically steer the sound in the direction you want and increase the SPL along the way.
We actually use waveguides.
We do use waveguides. If you look at the front plate of ours, this shape here, which looks really simple, that is acoustically a waveguide.
Okay.
And this shape is actually, if you change the shape, it changes the sound of the tweeter quite a lot.
Okay.
And we have been experimenting a lot with this shape, and this is the one we have been using for a long time. All of our domes have the same shape, and that shape physically dictates
the shape of the waveguide.
Okay. So this is the waveguide that works for this particular dome. So if we change the dome, we would also have to change the waveguide.
Mm.
But if you look at our products, whether it's from the smallest image speaker or the Evidence Platinum, all of them have exactly the same shape around the dome.
Okay.
So that's because it's not a matter of better or worse. It's a matter of this acoustically works with this kind of dome for what we are trying to achieve. Some may choose differently to get like higher SPL, for instance. We believe that have a balanced sound between the direct sound and the sound directed to the sides is what delivers the most accurate sound quality in the end. And we're not actually striving to get the highest possible SPL. We want the correct natural sound at a reasonable SPL. So, yeah.
Is it unusually small, our waveguide, or is it just...
I don't know if it's unusual. I guess that depends on what you're comparing to.
Yeah.
This is a physical property that basically most people have. I just think that most people don't think of it as a waveguide because it looks so small. And many waveguides can be very big. In the end, if you look around the high-end show, you can see waveguides that are several meters for a similarly small driver.
Okay.
That's also a waveguide. It's just a completely different design and a completely
different
approach.
Choices.
So you get some different aspects to it. But even if it's half a centimeter, it's still a waveguide. One interesting detail is if you look at the consequence, which is basically an evolution of a very old design, which the original came out in 1983. That actually uses a different waveguide.
Okay.
And that is more like a traditional waveguide, but that is a bit deeper and has a different spread. And that's basically a question of going in a different direction, where the consequence is a celebration to the old Dynaudio designs. So that's why we never changed it in that one.
Okay.
But currently we believe that this is what
the
makes
best design for our purpose.
And this is also why officially the Evidence Platinum is our top of the line speaker. Not specifically why. One of the points where the Evidence Platinum, we did consider that as a newer, better design. Although the consequence does have its fans.
I think that we have to stop now, Otto.
Sounds like it.
It sounds like they want to do a live demonstration of the special Forte.
That's what we're here for.
It is. And it became a little loud in here. So, but the good thing is we got all the way through the questions. So thank you so much for joining us again.
Thank you
for joining us as well.